Parental discretion is advised.
This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Just wait, just wait. It's the Wrestling Mayhem Show, episode 510. Tuesdays we've been doing this. Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on Twitter's in the Mayhem Studios in Pittsburgh, PA, Mayhem Central. We've got some very special guests joining us on the show. But first, let me round up the usual cast. First of all, joining us from San Antonio, Texas, he is Johnny Mundo's new best friend and the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling, Eamon Payton. How you doing?
I wouldn't go that far in that first one. I was in the presence of Johnny Mundo.
That counts.
It's close enough. But yeah, excited to be back as always.
Awesome. And also joining us from Floodtown, USA, Johnstown, PA, it is Bobby FJ Town.
Hey guys, we solved the problem with the Dollar Tree. They cleaned it up pretty well.
Oh good.
If you didn't watch last week's episode, that has no context.
An old person ran into the Dollar Tree last week.
Once again, yes. And also with us, we got some very special guests. First of all, on the couch, Stosh, and coming out to us from Detroit, New York. Detroit, Michigan.
Ninth Circle of Detroit.
Elliot from MaxXouT Band joining us. How you guys doing?
Oh, we're doing awesome. Thanks for having us. We're excited to talk about all kinds of dementia, including having Virgil hang out in my basement for a couple hours.
That's right. We get deep in that. I want to point out, we do get deep into that conversation about Virgil on Indie Mayhem Show that's going to release next week. That should be episode 111. So please go check that out. Our interview with MaxXouT Band, but they're joining us to talk pro wrestling with us. And it's like you mentioned Virgil. Tell us about MaxXouT Band. People can find more information about you and what the heck is up with Virgil.
I'd love to tell you all those things. Find out more info about us at www.maxoutband.com. And keep in mind, that's with two X's. Our full-length album just came out about a week and a half ago. Pick it up on iTunes. It's called The Big Push for obvious wrestling reasons. Pick it up on iTunes. It's on Google Play. It's on Amazon. It's even, Elliot doesn't want me to admit this, but you can even stream it on Spotify. And with all that, our first leadoff single for this spectacular debut album is the song Kayfabe. Again, more marking out with wrestling terminology, and it features the one and only WWE legend, the one Virgil.
That's right. That's right. Go check that out. It's a fantastic, fantastic video with wonderful, wonderful camera work, I understand.
Michael Sorg helped us with the camera work. He was excellent. We are very thankful to have him come out and work for us. He really held the whole thing together. If it wasn't for him, it'd probably just be a bunch of grainy footage of, horrible things involving me, Elliot, and Virgil. Just let your imagination wander.
It would have been
wander.
A whole other kind of music video. Elliot, you got anything to say?
No, man, that totally sums it up. Stosh, Virgil, MaxXouT. Oh, yeah, the video's on YouTube. MaxXouT Band Kayfabe music video on the YouTube. Check it out.
Awesome. All right. Well, it is your Wrestling Mayhem Show. We'd like to talk about the big time pro wrestling. This is the main show on the WrestlingMayhemShow.com. You can check out this and so many other shows like Indie Mayhem Show, where we do some interviews, Midweek War, the WWE Raw wrap up, and other things that pop up. The guys just talked about TNA Asylum Years episode 4, the fourth episode ever of TNA Wrestling. Back when they had some other letters attached to them, apparently. All that over WrestlingMayhemShow.com, articles, so much more. Matt Carlin's called out Dave Meltzer this week, and check out why in his open letter to Dave Meltzer about spoilers in Lucha Underground, a very hot topic out there on the internets this week. You can check that out, like I said, WrestlingMayhemShow.com and at Mayhem Show on the Twitter. Subscribe to us, iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio. YouTube, Facebook, a lot of videos on Facebook. A lot of guys watching us on Facebook, and I'm really appreciating that. A lot of comments there and on the YouTube lately as well. Drop us a line, 412-206-WMS0, or the email address goodtimes@wrestlingmayhemshow.com. Hey, apologies last week. I actually missed the voicemail. I forgot to bring it in on the show. But if you stuck around last week, there was a voicemail attached to the end of the show. And we do have another one around Mayhem Media again this week as well. So, you all right over there?
One just got quiet for some reason.
Oh, okay. I turned the wrong one down. That's why. So I was trying to adjust something over here.
No worries.
And also check us out on Patreon, patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Like I said at the top of the show, and thanks to our good friends that have supported the show through there, including the Jennifer and Matthew Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment, Ed Burke, the wrestlingrevolution.com, as well as our friend Bo Diggity. Yeah, you guys are slow today, guys. I didn't even get a good times. You guys didn't even give me a good times on the email address.
You went too fast.
You talked over it.
I suppose I forgot what show this was. Thank you. Thank you. Come on, it's a tradition. How long have we been doing this?
Too long.
Anyways, please go check out all that stuff and check out all of our friends and all of our affiliates streaming on the 405media.com and everywhere else. And t-shirts. We saw some great designs that Alice Cards are going to be putting out soon. But check out the Spreadshirt and check out our page over on prowrestlingtees.com/WMS. This week, oh man, so much happening this week. We could get even more into how great Raw was last night, but we did a whole lot of that on the Raw wrap-up. Please go check that out over on the site. But I think even more so, we need to touch on, because I don't think we have until since the very first announcements, but the Hall of Fame, the WWE Hall of Fame, is really starting to flesh out at this point, I guess you could say. So I think it's time to kind of address this. First of all, looking at the lineup, the most recent announcement yesterday, near and dear to my heart. I'm from this area. You guys, MaxXouT, we were talking about, your guys are from this era too. Eamon, probably not.
For a second, I thought you said from this area, and I had no idea that you lived in Cobb County.
The era, as you guys refer to, the superstar era on the Indie Mayhem show. The Big Boss Man is to be inducted in the WWE Hall of Fame. That's awesome. Presented by Mattel? What?
Nice.
But no, that's great. He... forget his Ray trailer, forget him pulling Big Show's dead daddy in a casket.
Don't forget that.
But other than that, no, I think he's one of the prominent guy of the era, namely that late 80s, early 90s era. He had a wrestling buddy. He was big enough to have a wrestling buddy.
That's Hall of Fame material right there, if you ask me.
There shouldn't be anybody with a wrestling buddy that isn't in the Hall of Fame. And I think he might have been the last one.
I think you're right.
Of that first set. Yep. Right?
Yeah.
So there you go. The wrestle buddy role is in full effect. I'm not talking about those bullshit WCW wrestling buddies either.
Or the Brodus Clay one,
or these new ones. No, those don't count. Maybe in like 20 years we can have that role as well. But no, I think Big Boss Man definitely belongs in there. What do you guys think?
Well, again, as we talked about on the indie show, I used to mark out to the Big Boss Man, especially in the 91 era when he turned face. And I'm not going to spread any rumors here or speak ill of the dead, but it was kind of weird that Big Boss Man, during the face run, magically lost probably about 60 or 70 pounds, and every match featured him sweating profusely and with completely round eyeballs. I'm not saying he was on any performance enhancing substances, but let's just say Big Boss Man might not have been following the protocol of being a law enforcement officer and may have been partaking in something that we know in the industry as the booger sugar.
I always hit up that evidence room pretty quick.
I remember that.
He got skinny and he sweated all the time.
I remember the sweat and the intensity.
Yes,
and that was an aspect I liked about him as a character.
Little did I know that this is just me loving things inspired by cocaine. It was just like Big Boss Man and Sylvester Stallone movies.
The WWF wrestlers back in the day.
Yeah, absolutely.
Wow. Yeah, it's that intensity, and he's just into it. Nope.
Okay, that means one of us has to cut a Big Boss Man promo right now. Any takers? Fine. You want me to do it? I'll do it.
All right. I mean, you seem game.
All right, I'll do it. I'll put the mic over here since it will involve a lot of screaming.
I'll get you over here. Okay. Go ahead.
Nails! You listen to me! You come over to Cobb County, Georgia! I have a history with you! I don't know. That's pretty much it. I just wanted to yell nails at the top of my lungs.
I thought you were going to go off into the time you read that poem about Big Show's dad, which is one of my favorite promos of all time.
And that's
my daddy.
Now, first of all, my favorite moment is the SummerSlam with the Mountie.
Oh,
yeah.
I mean, where the loser spends the night in the New York jail.
That's right.
And they kept going on about how horrible the New York City jail is.
Right.
That's where the Mountie whipped the camera off, too.
What's that?
The Mountie whipped the camera off, too.
Yeah, he did. And just remember how...
I got a finger for you.
It's a that's kind of my, but I think it's also important to remember he's a guy that did come back in the Attitude Era. Yeah. How many people came back in the Attitude Era from that previous era that made, I don't want to say the impact, I mean he was a lackey or whatever, right? But
he was there for a while, and was a big focal point.
4-time hardcore champion.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. Exactly. Right. Yep. I mean, he never had a belt when he was there before.
That's correct.
As the Twin Towers, as the other thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, really, and to see him come out, he even had a TV title or anything in WCW's Ray Trailer or
Probably not. I think he's a guy who goes in through his career is very underappreciated. Like he was a very solid, performer in the ring. I'm obviously, like you said, I wasn't watching during that era or any of the eras when he was wrestling, but I'm a late Big Boss Man fan because I really do enjoy his work. Like he was always very expressive in the ring. Mm-hmm. My favorite thing was when he would just like scream like during moves and stuff like that, or like let out a yell when he was like taking a bump or something. Like he was very good in making you care about the in-ring work through little things. And then, I think he's a really good addition to the Hall of Fame.
That's great.
He gave hope to pear-shaped kids like myself that I one day could – well, no, probably not. But, he was as a kid, he was always one of my favorites.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. My friend had his action figure. I was so jealous.
Had the nightstick.
I didn't have them, but,
Had the nightstick that every kid lost.
Yes, I mean,
let's be honest about it.
Yeah.
So, other than that, I mean, a lot of other news around the Hall of Fame. Of course, the Freebirds finally came in. So, if you're Mad Mike, I know you know. But if you've watched a lot of the Legends Roundtable on WWE Network or previously on WWE On Demand or 24/7, the running gag is about when is Michael Hayes going to get in the Hall of Fame? And maybe I thought it was just going to be a rib on him this whole time, but finally the Freebirds made it. I don't know any of the other Freebirds, but at least Michael P.S. Hayes is making it in to the Hall of Fame, baby.
I wish they would have done like a 1999 theme and they're just inducting him for that time that he managed the Hardy Boys.
Also appreciative. Ella, do you have any thoughts on Boss Man or the Freebirds going in?
Yeah, so as soon as you guys start talking about Big Boss Man skinny, I just went on a deep dive. Look at all the wrestlers who went on huge skinny binges. And I'm checking out the Blue Meanie skinny.
No. Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
That is a thing of beauty.
That
it was amazing, man. Like, I couldn't find a single Big Boss Man skinny pic though, man. I'm still looking.
It's kind of relative skinny. Like he went from being really big to like it's a little smaller, but still big.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
It's, but still, I don't know where to go from that. I just got caught.
I'm sorry.
I just had a moment because I just found him and Hogan in the big blue steel cage
on
Saturday night's main event here. So I'm kind of excited to watch this a little later.
Yeah.
I just want to go on that binge.
Oh.
Has anybody just like, and this is, I think I mentioned this a few weeks ago. Has anybody just like looked up a wrestler they want to check out and like say Chris Jericho or something? Like, let's just watch old Chris Jericho ECW matches, not in the show ECW. Just like, let's go watch him and Dean Malenko, him and Eddie Guerrero, like that stuff. Like I feel like I'm about to go on a deep dive of Big Boss Man matches here as I'm editing the show tonight at this point, because you can, and I think that's pretty amazing. But you could go on a Virgil playlist.
It'd just be kind of short, I think. You'd have SummerSlam 91 against DiBiase. And then when he got his nose broken, I can't really remember any of the other. Like, if we're just talking about him as a singles performer, not as, you know, valet.
I think you're gonna be surprised. I'm actually gonna plug in here, and this is the nice thing. This is a beautiful thing. Like, we have the Google of pro wrestling here in the WWE Network. I search for Virgil.
Ooh.
I'm waiting. Oh, there we go. There we go. We have some stuff. Wow, this is him as a heel in here. Hold on a second. We got Hercules Full Nelson's Virgil. Virgil submits.
Nice. Aww.
Virgil hit Razor Ramon hits Virgil with the razor's edge. All right, here's Hercules versus Virgil. Hercules versus
Hercules
Million Dollar
Virgil.
Man. Ted DiBiase with Virgil. There's a lot of with Virgil going on here.
Yeah.
Ultimore wins when Virgil interferes. You're seeing a theme here, right?
Yeah.
Diesel versus Virgil. Jeff Jarrett versus
Diesel
Virgil.
Diesel versus Virgil.
Oh, on man. Raw.
5 second match.
Dusty and Dustin versus Virgil and DiBiase. I was starting to watch that. I'm amazed. Goldust is in way better shape than he had ever been in his life, even when he was young.
Yeah,
it's astonishing.
It is.
Let's see.
If you want a good Virgil match, well, technically Virgil match that ties into our Big Boss Man talk, I think it's Starrcade 97 has a six man tag where it's Virgil on one side, the other side is the Steiner Brothers and Big Brother Rogers, and Virgil gets demolished.
It's a lot of humanity in the ring.
Oh, well, here's the other question: is do I have to actually type? Yeah, Vincent.
You have to type in Vincent.
Vincent.
This is the fun part. So, Buff Bagwell with Scott Norton versus Vincent and Booker T.
Oh,
okay,
God.
Luger and Norton with Buff Bagwell versus and Vincent. Norton
again with Vincent.
There you go. This is the big one. Norton, Horace Hogan, and Vincent versus Harlem Heat.
What?
Vincent gives Horace a small package to win. He wins on Nitro, guys.
That's awesome.
Oh, geez. This is the kind of Ernest the Cat Miller versus Vincent. Man.
That's great booking right there.
Right there.
Why did that place go defunct?
Vincent versus Stevie Ray. Did he have this like hot feud against Harlem Heat? What's going on?
God.
Oh, geez. Conan gives Vincent Tequila Sunrise to win.
Why are we not watching that right now?
This looks like the filthy. I think I'm going
Sign
to.
Me up for that
you guys,
one.
Yeah. You guys carry on to the show. I got some stuff to do over here. And again, Freebirds. You can dump it if you're not somebody that grew up with the Freebirds or anything. You can definitely dump in and see a bunch of that too.
Oh yeah.
Find that one WCW show I watched where they paint Confederate flags over their faces.
Yeah. Yeah.
Listen, man, it was a different time. Have you guys watched the most recent Edge and Christian episodes, which are getting better, by the way? I think the last two, I think they're hitting their stride for this. And if you're into the humor and not Eamon, because Eamon's not going to be into this 90s era humor like we are.
Oh, it's not even the fact that it's 90s. It's the fact that there's no actual jokes.
It's not the greatest thing.
No. It's definitely not the greatest thing, but I don't think it's meant to be the greatest thing.
No, it's definitely not.
Listen, I remember the MTV stuff where stuff was just stupid to be stupid in the 90s, and I think that's what they're aiming for. They're aiming for Beavis and Butthead humor here.
Yeah, I think.
I mean,
right.
Really, it is. And if you harken back to those days, sorry, Eamon, I think like, you know, the rest of us will kind of get into that as it goes here. And it's not like you're putting much effort into watching it. I don't think it's like, oh, it's Monday, gotta watch the latest Edge and Christian. No, it's kind of like, I got nothing else to watch, let's go watch the latest Edge and Christian. That was a okay use of a half an hour. But stuff like the references they're making, like we talked about last week, the Sunny lotion.
Oh, yeah, that was...
they just dropped the crazy ass Sunny reference. Or this week it was about the Mr. Fuji salt. Yeah, it was like, yes, it's racist. Yes, it's racist, but it was the '70s and we didn't know any better. Right. It's like, yeah. What? Like weird things like that, or the stuff that getting away on that show is pretty fantastic. They talk a little bit about what's going into it on the Talk is Jericho with Edge and Christian.
I will say I slightly like the video that you shared with us about them and Stardust going to like an elementary school and showing them all WWF jobbers.
You have to watch it, if the last episode 4, if nothing else, for the thread with Stardust, because there's a payoff.
I love Stardust.
there is a special appearance of Stardust at the end there that I don't want to spoil. But Eamon, especially, just go. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to go to that episode 4, okay? You got me? Are you following me here?
Sure.
Okay. I want you to go start with that segment that you saw with Stardust, because that's when he comes in the episode, and just watch until you see not Stardust.
Okay.
You'll know what I mean when you see it.
Hearken, Eamon.
Hearken.
Hearken.
Did you happen to see the end of Raw, or well, the after stuff they did on Raw last night?
Yes, yes. With Mark Stardust. Henry, the pizza, and Stardust is amazing.
Yeah,
I felt so bad for Stardust. Even his own brother. Like, he just wanted pizza. And it wasn't even real pizza. It was deep dish pizza.
Oh, there's no way from Chicago in the crowd. Anyways, back to the Hall of Fame. So Freebirds, of course, Godfather.
Yeah.
I hope when they do the retrospective, we do get the rest of his gimmicks. Right.
Papa Shango.
Papa,
I hope so, but they didn't. I remember they didn't do that last year with Rikishi.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, it was just Rikishi.
But I don't think Rikishi had another gimmick that was as significant.
Head shrinkers.
I feel like Papa Shango.
Yeah.
Is worth bringing up.
And we're not going to talk about Kama. I'm guessing. I never understood Kama because it was just like, I don't know if this is a topic that's been broached before, but like. Was the idea with Kama that he was like an MMA fighter? So it was like, you know, you're watching wrestling.
It's like what they thought MMA was. And like,
right. And they're like, this is a real fighter. Right. You know, we have a bunch of wrestlers, but Kama's an actual real fighting machine. Everybody else is just a gimmick. I mean, this guy's real. It's like, what the hell are you suggesting there?
I made
a sign when I went to Johnstown house show.
Oh, yeah.
It said, Kama, the supreme punctuation mark. And then on the other side, it said, double hey, don't do that for Jeff Jarrett.
Jesus.
Oh, no.
Straight out of 96.
That Kama had that hairdo, though. Look at that. I mean, why is this not being referenced in the Hall of Fame?
No kidding. Yeah. Good onesie to hair to traps ratio there. I mean, that's the golden ratio.
I will say the one thing about Godfather being inducted, I don't know, because they aren't showing them on Raw anymore, but like they'll post online like the kind of like retrospective videos of like, say, so-and-so's going to Hall of Fame. The Godfather one does a really interesting job of dancing around certain parts of the Godfather.
Yeah.
a lot of lack of the marijuana use.
Oh, I forgot about how heavy that was for that era. Yeah.
Suddenly, his catchphrase is no longer about rolling a fatty for this pimp daddy. It's just it's just staying pimping anything.
They just dub over, stay in school, kids.
Right.
And I think it was like, I think they were interviewing like Daniel Bryan about it or something. And he's like, I remember I would watch him and he would come out with all these women. Who wouldn't want to be around tons of women? Not to mention that he sold these women as property.
Was the finisher called the Ho Train?
It was called the Ho Train.
Wasn't him just like twirling his arms around and running in the corner?
Exactly.
It was like that episode of The Simpsons where they charged at each other and they were punching the air.
Yeah. I love if they were just going to revisionize like the whole thing. It's like his finisher, the locomotive.
The professional woman locomotive.
hey, happy National Women's Day, yes. Guys.
Yeah. You see Deadpool. Hey.
There you go. Hall of Fame, of course, Sting's going to be in there as well. I think it's the lineup so far that we're aware of. Mm-hmm. I'm sure there'll be somebody Japanese or Texan that we're not terribly aware of involved as well.
They leaked the other ones, but I won't
Well, I think it's interesting because Boss Man wasn't in the leaked list.
No.
So, you never know.
Okay. We'll see. I don't want to get into that. No spoilers. We're not Meltzer.
Yeah, no
spoilers. We're not Meltzer here. So there was some interesting other Hall of Fame news I want to touch on in this segment. So apparently they are planning to build the Hall of Fame, the actual physical Hall of Fame in Orlando, Florida, in advance of the now confirmed WrestleMania in Orlando next year in 2017.
Awesome.
So now
WrestleMania and Mario Sunshine?
Yeah, that logo.
That's what it looks like.
That logo, holy crap. But I think that's awesome. Now, when you go to Orlando, other than going to Full Sail to watch NXT, which who knows how long that's going to be, or stalking people at the Performance Center, now you'll actually have a place to go. And we know how that ends. That one guy that got shot. Yeah.
Skinner's going to be down there? What? Do you think Skinner's going to be down there at the Hall of Fame all the time? I'm trying to think of guys billed from Florida.
Well, yeah, he's not even involved in the training anymore, right?
That's right.
So,
yeah, he used to be.
But I don't, yeah, because he was kind of the head guy, I think, for Florida Championship Wrestling before it became NXT. So I don't know. But I think that's worthwhile. I don't think I want to visit it WrestleMania weekend, but certainly, like, you know, I think it would be nice to, like, take a trip down, check a few days of NXT tapings and roll down to the Hall of Fame. And it's kind of like another – Orlando's becoming this other kind of wrestling, not Mecca or anything, but a destination still. Mm-hmm. As you know, like New York has been for us for so many years with Madison Square Garden. I think that's kind of cool.
I heard it's supposed to be like a restaurant too.
Oh, no. We know how that goes. Yeah. We know how that works out for them.
So we're going to be in New York, Florida.
Has anybody, am I the only one that visited WWE Niagara Falls?
Oh, I've been there.
Yeah.
I didn't know. What is that? I didn't know there was a thing.
It's called Pile Driver, right?
Well, okay. Or something? So it was sort of in the style of the WWE New York, but it was more or less just like a physical WWE shop, right? Yeah. Like you go in and they had a big screen and whatever the latest video game was set up.
Right.
And I think, like, you went upstairs and it was like nothing. Like, it was like an event space or something that just, there was never anything there when I went. But then on the roof, because this is along that line, that one hill, Clifton Hill, I think, up in Niagara Falls, where all the haunted houses and the Ripley's, Believe It or Not, and everything is, all the really tourist trappy stuff is. So they had, not a roller coaster, but like a,
it was like an elevator,
like
thing,
a pitfall,
right?
like a Tower of Doom, or
they called it the Pile Driver.
They called it the Pile Driver, and it was just a ride that like you know shot you up and dropped you, and that was basically it. But it was on top of a building, and you could see Niagara Falls like a few blocks over, basically.
Right.
So it's been closed for several years now.
Yeah,
I was gonna say, is that where Shane's been, like having a stunt show, jumping off the falls every night?
I just want to do a thing where it's just like things Shane has been doing in the last 7 years.
Right.
So, I love the idea of him winning at Mania, like, to take over all. He just uses it to create like WWE China, and he's like, that's what I've been working on since I've left.
Exactly. Any other thoughts on the Hall of Fame so far, or the physical one, before we move on here, guys?
I do have to say that the theme entrances for these particular inductees are definitely Hall of Fame level. We got some great jams coming from these particular wrestlers. I'm impressed. We got Bad Street. We got Cobb County.
Oh, Bad Street.
Yeah. Yeah. Atlanta GA, buddy. I mean, that's
unfortunately, we'll probably get the rip off WWE's Sting thing.
Yeah, you're right.
Okay.
Have you guys ever seen Michael PSA's albums, by the way? I'm sure.
Don't let the children pray in school. Or let the children pray in school.
Exactly. You know what I'm talking about.
No.
Yeah.
What? Enlighten us.
Bobby, go for it, buddy.
He created an album. And one of the songs in the album is Let the Children Pray in School. If you haven't found it, YouTube it. It's amazing.
Yeah. Isn't there a song where he, like, visits Bam Bam Gordy's grave, too?
Yeah. Yeah, that's another one.
Wow. Are these in the list of covers that your band might do?
If we're playing in Bad Street Atlanta, GA, we're definitely going to play those songs. Elliot, learn the lyrics right now, man. Learn the lyrics. All right,
I'm on it. I'm Googling it.
It's Why Can't the Children Pray in School?
Jeez. All right, well, let us know your thoughts. WWF Hall of Fame, WWE Hall of Fame, jeez. And on Twitter, and if you're on the video for this, let us know your thoughts so far. And will you be visiting the physical Hall of Fame in Orlando, whether WrestleMania weekend or just, you know, while you're passing through Gator Country? So, hey, I want to give a shout out to our friends over at Slice on Broadway down here in Pittsburgh. You know, a lot of you on the show right now are in Pittsburgh even. But hey, we talk about the Mayhem bump on this show. We've seen it. We don't count Ray Lynn. She got hurt like a day after she was on the show. But we don't count that. No.
It's the exact opposite.
No. We're talking about our good friends, like Logan Shulo getting signed, Elias Sampson now into WWE, the Drifter. There was somebody else that had a really good Mayhem bump recently, too, that we talked to on the show. Help me out. I know we've been talking about it on the group. But it happens. It happens. We see people win championships, super indie championships after they've been on the show. But I think this might be one of the biggest of all. Our good friends supporting us with the perfect pepperoni pizza. I messed it up this week. Supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, Slice on Broadway. Locations here in Beachview on the tracks and on the main street in Carnegie, PA. Now, their new location. Ready? PNC Park, the home of the Pirates.
Nice.
There awesome. You go. Representing. So all those people coming in and getting a piece of Pittsburgh with the Pirates, I need to add to the line now.
Yes.
And now go check out Slice on Broadway right there in the park. Not just in the park, like inside at a game. Like it's actually going to be accessible. On Awesome Cast, we had our friends that work on the north side. I know there's a lot of you guys out there, or maybe you're just across Clemente Bridge and can make the hike over there, but you have access to this. You don't have to venture to the South Hills. Please still venture to the South Hills, especially with everything going on in Beachview where they're going to be tearing up the tracks, and these guys need to stay in business. Rico and the guys have been taking care of us for almost 2 years. Fresh pepperoni pizza. Okay, it's been there for a couple hours because we start this like at 5:30. But supporting the show and supporting getting guests, giving our reason for guests to join us in the studio and part of the neighborhood here for so long. So thank you to them. Congratulations to Slice on Broadway, sliceonbroadway.com, PGH_Slice on Twitter, Slice on Broadway on Facebook and Instagram. Let them know that you heard about them on the Wrestling Mayhem Show and congratulate them on getting into PNC Park. And make sure you guys visit and on Twitter or in person. Let them know you heard about it on the Wrestling Mayhem Show or the Sorgatron Media Network. Thank you. All right, guys, let's we need to talk about, there's a show Saturday, guys.
Yes.
Sure. And some of you guys have said in the chats and in everything, in the songs, by the way, are coming up in the chat room that we were talking about last segment. WWE Roadblock looks like, did we not have the best go home show in the past 12 months for a pay-per-view, mm-hmm. for something that's not even a pay-per-view?
A fake pay-per-view
that I will not be watching live because I have IWC's 15th anniversary show to work. So I am sort of conflicted here, but then again, I can just come home and watch this anyways. So this is in Toronto, so it's going to be a great crowd, I think. I think not as hot as I think we saw this past week in with
Chicago.
Thank you. But still, I think pretty decent. Just announced. Where's Matt Carlin's for this one? League of Nations, Sheamus and King Barrett will be taking on the New Day.
Is Sheamus and Barrett?
Yeah.
Sheamus and Barrett officially on the website.
Because I was told that Sheamus was wrestling Roman Reigns.
Mm-hmm. And it doesn't say
Roman's wrestling.
It doesn't say it's for the belt necessarily, but still, to see that Barrett's actually getting in the ring there, I think it's pretty significant since he's been kind of the. I mean, he's been in the six man tags and everything lately, but in general.
Oh, not super lately.
Well, no.
SmackDown was his first.
Yeah, in the past couple of weeks. In the past couple of weeks, he's been popping up. But other than that, we have Brock Lesnar versus Bray Wyatt. Huh?
Cool.
We wanted that at Mania.
Yeah. Well, mm-hmm. What's that?
Most of us wanted that at Mania.
We did.
Okay. I mean, but I think. Well, let's get into the rest of the card here. But I have some thoughts kind of going into this and what this could mean for other things. Jeez, WWE's website is absolutely insane right now. Because I don't know what page I'm supposed to be on.
You can keep scrolling.
I know you can keep scrolling, and there's another match. So it's now dictating the flow of the show as I keep scrolling and figure out what I'm hoping it brings up.
Joey Styles.
I'm hoping it brings up another Roback block match I haven't talked about, and not like a Total Divas recap. But anyways, I think a lot of you guys were really excited about this when it was announced on the Midweek War last week. Tag Team Champions Revival. Versus Enzo Amore and Colin Cassidy. Mm-hmm. That's cool. All right. Bring that NXT, kind of intermixing things a little bit. Yeah. It's not a pay-per-view per se. So I think there's a lot of opportunity there. Bobby and Eamon especially, I know you're big into the NXT stuff. What do you think about this coming to a big-ish show like this?
I think it's a smart move. I think, you know, nowadays NXT... you know, more well-known, obviously, in the realm, and it's not just that kind of niche sort of thing. So, yeah, why not feature it? And, I think it's interesting. I think my inkling is to think that this could be the when they get to end zone cast. But, hey, who knows?
It's a way to showcase Enzo and Cass before they come to the main roster.
Okay.
Yeah, that as well, yeah.
See how they fly and everything. I think they've been... doing dark matches in front of the crowd here for a little bit as well. I think a lot of guys are. Baron Corbin has been, I know. What's that? Eat that food. I think that's a really good note that NXT is going to be on the show like this. I was at the Arnold Classic, as I know you guys were as well. And did you get to see Triple H and Arnold out there?
Elliot did.
I did.
I walked in about that time too. So,
we didn't even see each other. We would have been like right next to each other because it wasn't that big.
Yeah, but everybody was there at the time, so it was impossible. Oh, yeah, man. We got over to one side.
The music hit, and you just saw a bunch of extremely ripped people just standing on tables trying to catch.
Yeah, it was crazy.
Just like our live shows.
It was awesome.
Right? Yeah, exactly. Just like our live shows. Just ripped people standing on tables.
It was definitely the most fit wrestling audience I've ever seen.
Yeah.
You know, there was definitely people that were definitely just there for NXT. But they did a Q&A with Triple H after Arnold left to go do Arnold things. And it was talking about like how like there's, you know, Brooklyn, they're having it the day before Takeover is going to be I think the day before the Hall of Fame and for WrestleMania weekend. He says I want them to go out there and tear the house down so that everybody that's up there for the big show, SummerSlam, WrestleMania, is like, oh damn, you know, and starts going back to the drawing board.
Right.
And I think we got that feeling. We definitely got that feeling SummerSlam weekend, didn't we? When they did that, I think it's been a pretty good success. And he wants the women to step up too, obviously, by what's going on there. It's pretty interesting. It's pretty interesting to see how that's going. So, and here it is. It's rising up to the big stage here. So,
absolutely.
Speaking of the big stage, Triple H himself, who was Snapchatting with Arnold this weekend, that was weird, taking on Dean Ambrose. This could be a kind of middle thing. Like, you know, this could be just like, let's throw Dino in there to make room while Roman recovers and he'll come back and we'll build up WrestleMania properly after this. Or I think Dean's getting a lot of people's hopes up. And I'm concerned.
Yeah, I my thoughts are very hopeful, obviously. My hope is that they call an audible. Not because I don't like Triple H, because I clearly do, but I think there's cases where, like, I think it'd be nice to see WWE realize, oh wait, this isn't gonna work. We need to try something different, try something new. This isn't gonna be the first time this year that they've obviously called some sort of audible with Mania. Like, I don't think, you know, I don't think it would be wrong to give the belt to Dean here and then maybe lead to something with him and Roman, you know, something along that line.
I explained yesterday on the Raw wrap-up, my level of expected shenanigans during this show are very, very high. Just like that Hell in a Cell with Shane and Undertaker, right? And especially with Wyatt kind of taking a fancy to the belt on Monday night, right? Brock obviously wants to be a part of it. Could we have, like, I think something funny is going to happen. And not ha-ha funny, necessarily.
Yeah.
But something goofy is going to happen. I feel like we're going to have something like the Daniel Bryan situation at 30, right? Similar, but some kind of multi-match. I can't imagine them just throwing all four people in a match or five people in a match.
The return of the championship scramble.
Oh, please no. That's like the worst idea for a WrestleMania ever. But
blame Stephanie.
Blame Stephanie, exactly. But I don't know. What do you guys think? Like, what? Like, how do you think this could kind of coalesce into something? Or does somebody who's injured is unexpectedly better, as John Cena is known to be?
Well, Cena did confirm that he will not be a WrestleMania.
Well, that son of a bitch before the Royal Rumble I attended said the same damn thing.
Yeah, well, he came out and said that he won't be competing at WrestleMania. Mm-hmm. I'm assuming he will be there in some capacity.
I think we're going to see some special guest referees. Yeah. I think we're going
to
have a...
It is crazy to think.
A myriad...
I mean, it is kind of crazy to think.
Good.
This is the first WrestleMania in 12 years that hasn't had a Cena match.
That's insane. That is absolutely insane to me right now. Wow. But I don't know. What do you think? Bobby, Sasha, Elliot?
Well, I guess my hope originally, was kind of that Roman would turn heel.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm guessing that's probably not going to happen. But that was kind of my dream right there, was something like that. But my guess is that I totally agree with you, is that we're probably going to see some sort of triple, quadruple threat situation.
Yeah.
Just because I'm a little worried that, oh, snap. Oh, there we go. Yeah, because I kind of understand where you're coming from. Maybe it's just not enough of a draw, Roman versus Triple H, for people.
Certainly. Certainly. Bobby, Sash?
I think there could be something that happens, but I still think it's going to be Roman and Triple H. I think they built that too much, and I think they've invested too much into that, so I'm thinking they're going to stick with it, as much as it pains me to say that.
Mm-hmm. But maybe it'll make it more interesting somehow.
Yeah,
you know. They've heard it a little bit. Like, again, the detour to WrestleMania, if we're not tired of wrestling puns. They're even making the road puns at this point. Has anybody noticed this week? But there you go. Well, WWE Roadblock, we'll be watching it at some time. I almost wish it was at 5 in the morning again, so I know I'd be able to watch it. But but hey, some people have to do things on Saturday nights. So
Sunday night, like a regular pay-per-view.
Yeah, Sunday night, like a regular pay-per-view. What the hell, guys? Is this in our house show? They just like dropped.
Yeah.
Oh, I got this ticket to this awesome house show coming up. Hey, guys, special event.
Right.
Just like
originally it was called March to WrestleMania.
Yeah. Well, which isn't that their live tour? Like, isn't everything March to WrestleMania in the month of March or whatever?
Right. Yeah.
So. And not to mention, I know several of us from the Wrestling Mayhem Show will be in attendance. Sorry, Cortana apparently kicked on in the middle of my Bobby's face over here. But in a distract. No, you're not sorry. Don't be sorry. It's my computer. It just binged.
I'm sorry, I have Cortana's face.
Bobby, it just binged over your face. Bobby got binged, and it's weird.
Wouldn't be the first time.
Hey now. But anyways, no. So Rob will be in Pittsburgh on Monday, so we'll have a lot of people firsthand as well about whatever goes on there. It usually gets pretty interesting in Pittsburgh. So
Heeltown,
USA.
That's right.
I'm surprised they're still letting us have Raw days.
Yeah.
But then again, look at Chicago. We ruined the Royal Rumble and made CM Punk go away.
Yep.
We scared Rey Mysterio out of the WWE.
That too.
And killed the Batista reboot.
And CM Punk.
Yep.
uh, and created Bautista.
Bautista.
All right, guys. Well, hey, go check out. Hey, check. If you like wrestling that you're probably not going to boo, go over to indiewrestling.us, guys. A lot of stuff going on over there. The digital downloads and DVD pre-orders for IWC's Proving Ground 5. A great main event with friends of the show, Darren De Niro, who's been getting around a lot, including I think he made it on Raw during the Tough Enough casting calls when those videos were going out. And he's done a lot of cool stuff, taking on IWC champion Jimmy Nuts. Great show, a lot of new people. There's an interesting new guy. As much as I paused at his name, Shane Inyaface. He's an MMA crossover guy that has debut, and I think he's gonna, they're gonna have a lot of fun with him here in the coming weeks. You guys are actually gonna see him taking on another friend of the show, Dylan Bostic at IWC's 15. If you're in the Pittsburgh area this weekend, I'll also be available shortly after on digital download and DVD at indiewrestling.us. But also, we threw some old school ones up there too. Some stuff we've never really released on digital download, including AD After DeMarco. These are from around 2011, I believe. Night of the Superstars with Mick Foley, Chavo Guerrero versus DJ Zima Ion. Before, I think he was Zima Ion. And Tracy Brooks against Gail Kim. Carlito's a part of that card as well. A lot of good stuff there. November Pain, Zima Ion versus Ray Rowe. Wrap your head around that one if you're not familiar with their indie days. Some good stuff from November Pain 4. IndieWrestling.us. Sign up for the newsletter. Check out the great Around the Indies column by Mainstream Matt. He catches you up on the weekend. Not up yet, but I know it's in progress. He was busy with the Arnold Classic this weekend. We were talking a lot of NXT guys. Oh, look at these guys. Look at these guys over here.
Woohoo!
Look at that. Is that some guys with Virgil over yes. there? On indiewrestling.us. You can get we got the video posted as well. And if you can't get enough Virgil, we do have Legend of Virgil and his traveling merchandise table is available right there on indiewrestling.us. And yeah, it's some good stuff. And get Virgil-fied, guys.
You can never have enough Virgil in your life.
Certainly not. Nothing like this. It's like I think it's nearly 2 hours of just shooting the shit with Virgil. So check that out. Hey, let's thank you. The MaxXouT band is still with us. They're going to stick around for the big question and Mayhem Mania. Oh boy, Mainstream Matt is not here tonight. I don't know how this is going to go yet. So we'll see how that goes. But go check out a little bit from our big party looking for Group Pittsburgh from our 10-year anniversary show. Another flashback, if you will. I'll be right back with a big question.
The first time I met the Mayhem was at PodCamp 1. The very first one. That's why they call it PodCamp 1. It was later in the afternoon. I think it was 2 days then. Yeah, it was 2 days. It was later in the day on Saturday, and Kanaki sees myself and Sick Puppy walking around. He goes, you know what? I've got some guys you need to meet. They're down in the basement. And we're like, okay, well, already the beer guys are being sent downstairs. This figures, but whatever. So we go downstairs, and he goes, go in here and hang out with these guys. And it was the wrestling guys. We're like, wrestling? Sure. We'll check this out. And when we went in, we were the only two in there. And there, Sorg has video of this. My big bald head is like right in front of the camera, down front, next to Sick Puppy. And little did we know, the whole thing filled up really quick. So we sat through the session, and we got the guys to basically just kick the tar out of each other. They did a kick to the face, a hit with a chair, a few other things. So that was my first real interaction with the Mayhem guys. And we bonded ever since, because we figured wrestling, beer, wrestling. Yeah, it kind of goes together.
Wrestling Mayhem Show. We are back, ready for the big question. The crew is here. MaxXouT, Stosh and Elliot, Eamon, Bobby FJ Town, ready to rock it with the second half of the show. So the big question this week. Obviously, we got WWE Roadblock coming up this weekend as of this recording. And WWE has always had some really interesting kind of, I don't know if I want to call them experimental shows or one-off shows, or maybe they had a couple of them, you know, and you know, some interesting concepts, or WCW or ECW even, if you want to count that, some of those. So I thought we'd go around the horn, and the big question is, I want to make sure I word this right. What is your favorite, let's just call them oddball one-off-ish shows that that you've had over the years that kind of stick out in your mind? If I can set the pace here, what I'm thinking, and I talked about this before on the show, I've always been, I don't know if it's because I found the tape back at the video shelf back home and rented it all the time and ended up purchasing the tape when it was previously viewed. But there was this weird, I presume, closed caption show that they did called The Big Event. It was at wherever the Blue Jays, Blue Jays, Toronto. I believe it was in Toronto.
Hmm.
I'm going to try to bring it up here. It was actually the only one that I'm aware of the era, WWF Baseball Stadium Show, headlined by Paul Orndorff.
Yes. Versus, two arms at that point?
Yes, very much two arms at this point. Versus Hulk Hogan for the championship. And yeah, there it is. There is the big event. There's some graphics from it. That's what the VHS looks like. Coliseum home video.
Yes.
Just nice low shot of Hulk Hogan, which is probably appropriate considering the most recent news in the Gawker thing that I'm not getting into. Hold on. I'm going to pull up some info here. It emanated in at August 28th, 1986, ooh, Exhibition Stadium in Toronto, Ontario. Again, I believe that's where the Blue Jays played at the time. Highlights from this, for me, were Ricky Steamboat and Jake Roberts in a snake pit match.
Oh,
I can't remember the rules of a snake pit match, but I know, I'm pretty sure this is back when Ricky Steamboat was taking a kimono dragon to the ring.
Oh, man.
And Bobby Heenan was wondering about it, or whoever was announcing was worried about it getting out and into the river in Toronto. You guys remember the Machines?
Yes, I remember the Machines.
And Giant Machine.
Yes.
Giant Machine, who may bear a resemblance to Andre the Giant.
No.
Maybe. There you go. Rujo's faces against the Dream Team. This was one of my only early interactions while watching the Dream Team of Greg Valentine and Bruce Beefcake before he cut hair. Junkyard Dog, Adrian Adonis. I mean, this was... What is happening?
Scissors.
Scissors. Oh, there, Bobby. Got to get you with the scissors. Do it, man.
Boom, bum, beautiful Bobby Beefcake. Yeah. Beautiful Bobby Beefcake.
There you go. Yeah. Beautiful Bobby. Beautiful Bobby Adonis. That was kind of, it happened one time. It was kind of its own thing, and it had a different feel to everything else. So that was mine. And there's several different ways you guys can take this. Who's got an event they want to share?
Ooh, I got one that I'm pretty excited about. It just hit me like a lightning bolt, and that is this Tuesday in Texas.
Ooh.
You guys remember that?
Ooh.
That was the first time that I knew that the WWF at the time was just trying to screw me out of paying more pay-per-view money. And because if you recall, it was Survivor Series 91, I believe, mm-hmm, where The Undertaker beat The Undertaker beat Hulk Hogan. No, yeah, with help from Ric Flair, right? That was the plot.
Yeah.
And I can't remember. I think Jack Tunney came out and cut a promo about this being just a total injustice in the world of wrestling, and that it should never happen, that, you know, Ric Flair slipped a steel chair when Hogan was getting tombstone pile driven. Because of course it could never be a clean finish with our friend who's currently testifying about certain things. And so they had to have a makeup pay-per-view the Tuesday, 2 days after the Survivor Series of that Sunday. So, and the thing was, is it was a pay-per-view. You had to pay again to get this Tuesday in Texas. And I think you got a discount if you had bought the Survivor Series 91 show, but if you and you had to prove it somehow, probably with like carbon copy paper and fax machines, because again, we're talking about 1991. But, you know, the only match I really remember from if it's This Tuesday in Texas, I think that's the title of it, or just Tuesday in Texas. I can't really remember.
It's a little bit of both. I think it's officially this. No, it is This Tuesday in Texas, actually, yeah, okay, according to this graphic. I had never actually seen this.
Oh, I saw it.
The WWE Network.
Oh, really?
Because it was one of those first things. I'm like, I can finally see Tuesday in Texas.
Yeah.
After all these years.
And the only match I remember is Hogan and Undertaker, and obviously Hogan going over because God forbid he dropped the strap for more than 48 hours. But I don't remember the rest of the card, even though I watched it while it was happening. But that's the one I wanted to stroll down nostalgia and memory lane. And
by the way, emanating from San Antonio, Texas.
Oh, there we go.
Hey,
you got a
hey there.
Disappointing 1.0 buy rate.
Oh no!
Oh no!
Who else is on the card? Do you have it? Do you have it?
Have it here on the wiki machine, and I don't think all of these were on the pay per view necessarily.
It was really short. There from what I remember,
there were 8 dark matches.
Oh wow!
Nice. And the dark matches seem more interesting than the actual show. Remember, this was the big payoff of Randy Savage against Jake Roberts with the snake bite.
Oh.
Repo and Ted DiBiase against El Matador and Virgil.
What's that match? That's
just
so
weird. Just can't stop him.
You know, nope. Bret Hart defeated Skinner.
God. What a God,
Bulldog, man. The British Bulldog against defeated Warlord. Now here's
Bulldog
the,
and Warlord.
Here's
Jesus,
the dark match.
The Diana Ball match. Diana Ball on a pole match.
But like the dark matches were Legion of Doom against the Beverleys, Ric Flair against Piper, Nasty Boys and Bushwhackers, Valentine and the Brawler. Oh, and then
Flair
it gets the other names. But
how could they not show Flair and Piper?
I know. Were they taped for something else? Maybe they were taped for like a Saturday Night's main event or something?
Maybe. I just remember it was really short. And yeah, that was another thing where you paid all this money and it was a really short pay-per-view.
It was 5 matches.
Yeah, it was.
It's insane.
Yeah. And I still.
Is that the first thing in your house?
Pretty much.
See, I was absolutely confused because I had no cable at this point.
Right.
And I'm like, what? There's another thing? What? And yeah. And this is the thing. At a time, if there was a big pay-per-view like a Royal Rumble, that meant I get to go to my grocery store and there was a program. There was a program that I could buy.
Nice.
For the Royal Rumble. I wouldn't see the Royal Rumble until like 3 months down the line when it came out on VHS
yep.
tape
Coliseum
from Coliseum Home Video.
Yep.
Bing. But I got to hear about it, what happened. I got to look at the matches and I get amazed when the matches actually on there didn't entirely match.
Ooh.
I went through one of the Royal Rumbles to see where everybody was in the program.
Oh, man. What year do you remember?
This is probably 90, 91-ish.
Okay.
I was getting these. I have a couple of the SummerSlam ones, too. I still have them here, actually.
That's awesome.
Some of them are probably marked up because I think I put, like, win-loss things. Yeah. And
91, Rick Martel. He went for a long time. In
that's
that
right.
One.
Those were the days. Those were the days. Eamon, do you have a show?
I do have a show, and I had a feeling this would count. This would sort of count. Stay with me. And it's kind of an older one from my time. I think I was maybe 2 when this came out. So stay with me. But I remember I watched it from DVD compilations I was getting that featured matches from this show. And so I kind of just eventually discovered more of it. I mean, technically it's from a major promotion because it was produced by WCW. But it's the AAA When Worlds Collide event, I think from 94, I want to say. And it was basically the first time that it had gotten broadcasted to like a major audience. And I believe there was American commentary and there was the opportunity for Americans to kind of see that style of Lucha Libre. There's a very young Rey Mysterio in it. Which I remember, I believe it's on the like Rey Mysterio's first like WWE DVD. There's a really good Eddie Guerrero Art Barr tag team match. There's good stuff on there, and I think it was my first glimpse as a new fan getting into wrestling of Lucha Libre. And it's very different, obviously. And this is in Los Angeles, actually, at the LA whatever there's. I guess the Sportatorium, whatever building it was. But very different, obviously, and very cool to see that being broadcast it on that kind of a level.
So they do have videos.
And obviously, it was a precursor to the stuff with the Cruiserweight from WCW.
Right. They do have at least clips on WWE.com. I'm trying to see if they actually included like with WCW as far as you say it was officially like promoted by them. Is that the case?
I believe it was promoted, and I know it was produced by WCW's team.
I'm not immediately seeing it, unfortunately. Just a quick search.
That'd be a great thing to release, though.
That'd be a great thing if they did. They have it, and they have clips of it on WWE.com. So I wonder if that's one of those things that, you know, dig it up. Hey, write your WWE Wrestling Network representative and see if they'll put it out there.
Because it was the only time they had the show. Like, it was one show. So
yeah. Well, that'd be weird. You do some digging. Elliot, do you have a show you want to share?
Well, I started trying to jog my memory in the Wikipedia, and then I saw one that I haven't seen that I need to see called It Ain't Seinfeld.
What?
This literally happened. This is an event that happened in ECW the day the last episode of Seinfeld aired. They had
it. Oh, that's amazing.
It's not on the network, so you're going to have to YouTube it. But if you do, or whatever, you got to find it some other kind of way. I don't know. You got to find a VHS at a VHS store or something. But the logo is freaking outstanding. So just Google image of the logo. It's great. But yeah, so ECW had It Ain't Seinfeld airing the same night as the last episode of Seinfeld. So.
Coincidentally, that's also the porn parody of Seinfeld's name.
Oh, really?
I don't know if it is or not.
That's great.
Oh, no. This is, you know, actually, if you look at the cover of the ECW release for this, you really can't tell a difference in quality from a porn release. So, I mean, that is some rough photoshopping going on there in 1990, whatever. Wow.
What's the card? Who's on it?
Featuring Bam Bam Bigelow, ooh, Tommy Dreamer, Sabu, and Just Incredible. Hey, did you see Sabu at the Arnold?
No!
Just walking around?
What?
In a suit in the head towel?
I didn't see that.
Matt Carlin said, Mainstream Matt side. I'm just like, what? I'm so pissed. Just like, we got done interviewing the NXT guys for him, and he's like, he tells me afterwards, he's like, I had it in my head, I know I'm going to run into another wrestler here. And I was like, I'm completely going to talk to him and see if we could talk to him. And he's like, he saw Sabu. He's like, I'm not talking to Sabu. I'm not talking to Sabu.
Where was he? Was he by the NXT stuff?
He was near the main stage when we saw him. This was late Saturday. So
damn it.
We should probably
I'm
have a
so disappointed.
We should probably have a small segment where we talk about wrestling at the Arnold here in a little bit.
Yeah.
But let's do that after Mayhem Mania here. So teaser. Who did we, Bobby? I think you haven't gone, right?
I haven't gone yet.
Yeah, yeah. What do you got?
I'm also going to go with the Tuesday night event.
Ooh.
But mine is based solely on the fact that Gene Snitsky said this the best. Taboo Tuesday. that's what I remember from Gene Snitsky and Kane, their feud. Him just saying, I'll see you at Taboo Tuesday. The Kane, but it also had Sergeant Slaughter.
It's also a porno, by the way.
it had Sergeant Slaughter versus Muhammad Hassan.
Oh, wow.
Sheldon Benjamin versus Chris Jericho. Trish Stratus, Molly Holly, Stacey Keebler, Victoria, Gail Kim, Jazz, and Nydia.
Man, also a porno.
And a Fulfill Your Fantasy Battle Royal.
What?
That was the one where you get to decide what sex the app.
The cool thing about this pay-per-view was people got to vote on things via the internet in the early ages of the internet.
In 2004. I want to point out.
Not that early.
Look at this cover art.
Early enough.
Look at that giant CRT monitor with the World Championship belt in it.
Oh, it's great.
I remember Taboo Tuesday was one of my favorite pay-per-view sets because it was basically a giant computer screen with like a keyboard as the ring.
They really
the main event was actually the Randy Orton versus Ric Flair in a steel cage match, so that's cool.
Which was also it was pretty fantastic, and it was different, and it was fascinating because it was 2004, 2005, and I think it just became Cyber Sunday for a couple of years. They only had two Tuesday ones.
Yeah.
I don't get WWE's fascination with wanting to do Tuesday night pay-per-views. Like, I want to know why. Can somebody just explain to me? Because also, I noticed when I was looking at the Wikipedia for the first Taboo Tuesday, Eamon, it said this was their first Tuesday pay-per-view since Beware of Dog was apparently on a Tuesday. The In Your House, In Your House 8, Beware of Dog.
Jeez.
Yeah. Yeah. Is that the one? Oh, I'm sorry. Beware of Dog 2 in 1996.
Electric Boogaloo.
The first
one. Electric Boogaloo.
Yeah, exactly. And from the chat room, Garza is saying the original White Knight stands, the ones that were actually about ECW.
Yeah, those
were absolutely
awesome.
Yeah, those were great. Yeah. All right. Well, let us know. Hashtag WMS big question. What is what kind of weird one off couple off shows? I know we kind of talked about off air sold out. And,
yep.
And going back, and that's back when I was watching, we were buying every WCW pay-per-view because we were down with the whole NWO thing.
Yeah.
and just into it.
Right.
And then we saw Sold Out come up, and like, we'll skip this one.
Yeah, a Saturday pay-per-view, if I remember correctly.
Was it? Oh,
it
geez.
Was, yeah, and it was in beautiful downtown Cedar Rapids, Iowa, in the middle of winter. It was actually the day before the Super Bowl. It was the Saturday before the Super Bowl, and
wow.
The only reason I remember that is because it was the Super Bowl where my Green Bay Packers beat the New England Patriots back in 96.
Yeah.
Nice. But the funny thing about it, and I don't know if you remember this or not, but they had this big contest to name Miss NWO. But then the problem again is that you're having this event take place in winter in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. So the selection of beautiful women from Iowa was slim pickings. And so they went and they did this spot over and over again that eventually resulted in Eric Bischoff like – making out with some woman from Iowa. But they did like a profile of all the various contestants of the Miss Iowas. And what I remember is that, and I don't think this was a work. I think this was legitimately their professions. There was two people who were grain silo, like surveyors. They're separate people. Two women were both grain silo surveyors. And then there was a third woman. Yeah. There's a third woman whose hobbies included detailing trucks and frying bratwurst. And I believe she was the one who won. Now I'm just like, you know what? I think she should win because if you got a woman who can fry up some bratwurst for you and then clean your truck, I think that is a keeper in Iowa and Cedar Rapids. So, you know, kudos to WCW for actually booking something correctly back in 1996.
Another thing that I had to watch after I got the WWE Network because I never had. And I'm so glad. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. It has become one of my favorite WCW train wrecks. All right. All right. Big question. Thank you so much, everybody. And please check that out. All right. So it's time for Mayhem Mania. Do I have enough? 1, 2, 3, 4 people here. Actually, I think there needs to be a fifth.
What's the official rule book?
The official rule book. We usually have 5 picks, I thought. So I think
Section 8
of the rule book. So it is time for Mayhem Mania. I should probably use my titles a little bit here. We'll see how this goes. If he's available, can you bring Garza in, please, Eamon?
We
need to tag Garza in. Sorry about that. I didn't prepare. We're a little bit of a scramble. Mainstream Matt is not with us this evening. He's got some stuff to do. I don't know, politics or something. Covering the news.
Interviewing
NXT superstars. Chatting it up with Baron Corbin apparently. Let us know, trying to figure out if I forget the little girl's name.
Alexa Bliss.
We figured out if Alexa Bliss will fit in his pocket. She's so tiny. She's so absolutely tiny. It's crazy. The people shouldn't be that tiny and be normal sized people. But anyways. So it's time for the Mayhem Mania. I'm cutting that part out. It's time for the Mayhem Mania. Okay, so Sasha Elliott, you guys are new to this. So I will explain the rules as well as I can, as he does every week. This is kind of a thought experiment. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So the idea is the goal is to try to book the best WrestleMania card possible, not necessarily to predict what WWE will do. Let's be honest. They're fairly unpredictable right now anyways. It's not fantasy booking, even though it kind of is, and I'm completely reading from the article. Any match created must be possible in real life. That means all wrestlers come in their current physical, emotional, and contractual state. Anyone selected for a match must have a reasonable chance of being hired by WWE to appear on a real-life WrestleMania card. Simply put, we have to play by the same rules as Vince McMahon. Okay?
So, to elaborate on that, i.e., John Cena can't be on this card because he's out injured.
Yes. Yes. So we are going into round 8 officially. Who did I... Somebody popped off here. I think I lost Eamon's video here, but did you jump out and back? I think I just lost you like on.
Okay, man.
Okay. I think I just popped it a bit. You got a serious face going on there, Garza, or is that your icon? I'm not entirely sure. Looks like you're staring at me. I don't know. I'm scared. Garza's scaring
Garza
me out. Hang
is
out. You may be frozen, frozen in angry face. Okay. Anyways, back to this. Okay. So this is round 8, and we have a list of matches that we've been going and creating and changing, and you have a few options here. 5 members of the universe, of the WMS universe, are chosen this week, or picked out of the chat room in this case, to move or change the card. You have 3 options. 1, you can swap a wrestler or tag team with another already on the card. So if there's a guy in this match, you can do a switcheroo. Okay? You can add an unused wrestler or tag team to an existing match. Somebody that's not on the card already, again, within the realm. You can trade a wrestler or match for an entirely new match with unused wrestlers. You can wipe an entire match and just hey, this guy hasn't been used. Here we go. In addition, there's a new subtract option still in play. It can be used to remove one person from any match. Singles match is not eligible. That would be a little bit weird. Hey, Eamon, can you do me a real quick thing?
Sure.
Can you give me an order? Since you're last, so you don't affect the rest of the order. Can you give me an order in Slack of the people here so I have something to go off of before I finish these rules? Any match that survives 3 rounds in Mayhem Mania without being altered graduates to the supercard. And it finally happened in round 7 last week as, and we'll pop this up here, we did get a graduation created by Eamon a few weeks ago. Finn Balor versus Kevin Owens versus Sami Zayn is currently on our supercard, our final for Mayhem Mania. So beyond that, that means the slot for a new match has been created in the undercard. Since Eamon created the match that graduated, he got to create the new match filling that opening. We'll get to that in a moment. In addition, he was granted a second prize, the Eliminator. He can use this at any time to remove any single person from Mayhem Mania. Those on the current card are protected from the Eliminator.
Completely.
Absolutely. He also got the last move in round 8 under the Alex Cards rule and got to hand out a dose of punishment to one of the other participants, forcing one to spin the wheel of NXT tag team champions, not named Enzo and Big Cass. So that was the punishment. It was spun a wheel. Those two weren't on it, and it got to be used. And so the matches so far, and I got some other rules I have in here too. It's got really complicated. Really, really complicated. Okay. All right, the matches so far that we have. This is why we put this at the end of the show. We have Apollo Crews versus Brock Lesnar versus Bray Wyatt. Apparently, I created this. I don't remember creating this. Did I create this? This is a good fucking match.
You did create this.
That's a good match.
Wow. So there you go. We have Shinsuke Nakamura versus Kalisto versus AJ Styles, made for from our boy Wheels from the Renegade Wrestling Alliance. We have The Ascension versus Stardust and Goldust getting back together versus Arrow himself, Steve Amell, and Neville in a tag team match. By the way, props to Antonio Garza of thewrestlingrevolution.com, who's joining us here on the line from El Paso for the getting these graphics together. Last week, Eamon also put together Mojo Rawley versus Baron Corbin. In a battle of the Samoans, what was it? Was it a battle of who's the Rock's real cousin or something? Jimmy Uso versus Roman Reigns versus Nia Jax versus Jey Uso. Created by Antonio Garza. created by Mad Mike, Enzo Amore, and Colin Cassidy versus Ronda Rousey and Shane McMahon. What the hell were we doing last week? Blake and Murphy versus The Revival versus American Alpha, which I think used half of the NXT wheel by Bobby F. J-Town last week. And finally, Dean Ambrose in a suit, really funny considering his promo on Raw this week, versus Rusev, also in a suit that also looks like it's squeezing his head out, by the way. Not judging your work, Garza. Not judging. Not judging. I'm judging Rusev's oddly shaped head. So there you go. That's what we got. Those are the matches as they are. I need to do something. I need to do something, something, something. Do you have that list ready for me, Eamon?
Sure. I said Bobby goes first.
Bobby, you're going to go first. I'm going to do a mad scramble to make sure I can actually change matches on here. And Bobby, what do you want to do?
I am going to use the subtract stipulation that Matt said one of us gets.
And I believe this could
since
be
Amos
this could
punished me last week.
This could only be used once, period, right?
Yes.
Like
yes.
By anybody for the rest of this year.
I'm going to use it to fix my match. I'm sorry, Wheels. Take Kalisto out of that Shinsuke versus AJ match.
Nice.
So you're taking
taking Kalisto from the Shinsuke Nakamura versus AJ Styles match.
So we're back to AJ Styles versus Shinsuke Nakamura. Can we go back to the graphic where it looked like Nakamura was giving AJ Styles a back
shoulder
a shoulder massage? So we can just reuse that graphic, Garza. Okay, you got that?
Okay.
All right. We're good. That was a good pick. Good pick, Bobby. All right, according to the Slack, next up is Antonio Garza. I love in-studio guest and then other guest. We haven't learned names of who's on the show yet.
Sorry.
It's all right. You don't get the titles on the feedback loop. I understand.
I don't see, yeah.
I mean, you can handle your punishment.
I'm sorry.
There's a lot of rules, guys.
Oh yeah, there is. Hold on. Okay, I guess I did skip that part. Hold on. I'm trying to find his message here. Let's see. Oh, I forgot to. Okay, now you have your punishment under the Alex Carr's rules. You hand out the punishment, and it's to be administered during that player's turn. The punishment. Oh damn, where's the punishment? There it is. This week. We have the Wheel of Nexus. Now he had some tough choices to make. The Wheel of Nexus. I hope Bobby wasn't going to get a punishment. Is that right, Eamon?
I got it last week, Eamon.
So
yeah, I was. Gonna, do you, Bobby? Before I ask, because I thought you wanted the one last week. Do you want this punishment?
Nope.
You already made your match. Okay, I screwed that up, but you already made your match. So the wheel of Nexus includes original Nexus members Michael Tarver, Darren Young, Wade Barrett, Heath Slater, David Otunga, and Ryback, which at the time was Skip Sheffield. Yep.
Okay.
No McGillicuddy. No Husky Harris.
To bring back Tarver.
Yeah, I
was gonna say I don't know if Tarver applies.
Because I mean, if I can bring Tarver, I can bring back Daniel Bryan, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Within the realm of the Wheel of Nexus, Tarver is not injured. He's just lost in Cleveland. Okay, I'm just going. Hopefully, we don't have to answer that question.
Question. Then Sorg obviously didn't make these rules, so I don't.
No. I believe I'm free to. Make up the rest of the rules as we go.
Can I give this punishment to myself?
Yes.
I think
I literally don't know what I'm going to do this week.
Absolutely.
So might as well.
Absolutely. I think you can give it to yourself. I think you can punish yourself.
Cause havoc, Eamon.
I've already broken all the rules on this show, so whatever.
Okay.
I'll give it to myself.
All right. So you're going to do the wheel. We're going to spin the wheel.
Because I go last.
Oh, you go last. That's right. Yeah, not going to spin the wheel. Garza, you're up next.
Okay.
This was not a good idea to have me take this over.
No, you're doing fine.
I didn't really have a chance to like think about this all day. So
since we just told you to come in here,
like really quickly talking and making time while I see the roster in WWE.com, because I cannot remember by the left of me who's still employed. Okay.
I know it's hard.
Yeah. So I'm going to remove the Ascension versus Stardust and Goldust versus Samel and Neville match.
Oh, the whole match?
Yes.
You're just
that was a pain in the ass to draw.
You don't want to draw that anymore.
And I'm going to replace it with newly officially signed Austin Aries versus Alberto El Patron.
Oh, nice. Oh, excuse me. He doesn't count. There's an Alberto Del Rio. I know there's an.
Oh, sorry. Alberto Del Rio.
Excuse yourself.
Okay. So now we have Austin Aries versus Alberto Del Rio. We have removed the Ascension versus Goldust and Stardust versus Stephen Amell and Neville. I want to just point out Stephen Amell is now back on the table as a valid possibility. Okay, from that, what was it? In studio guest first, right?
Awesome.
So Stosh. One, do you understand anything that's going on right now?
I'm
going
to give it a shot.
All right.
If I screw up.
Use it. I'll let you know if we accidentally said something that's already on there. I know you're not terribly... I don't have a big board like the other guy, unfortunately.
I'm trying to look it up.
Yeah.
I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the Samoan death match, and I'm going to add... Can I add The Rock to the Samoans? I mean, doesn't that seem...
The Rock wants to be The Rock's cousin?
Yeah. let's do it. Let's add The Rock to the Samoan death match.
All right. So we have the Samoan death match that now entitles The Rock, Jimmy Uso, Jey Uso, Roman Reigns, and Nia Jax, presented by MaxXouT.
Yes.
There you go. You got that? You can get their logo there.
If The Rock wins, no one gets to be his cousin.
He's his own grandpa.
Presented by... All right, Elliot, it is your turn. What do you got for me?
I'm struggling here, guys, because I can't decide. Because I see this match right here, which is Mojo Rawley versus Baron Corbin. And I can't decide, and I kind of want you guys' advice. I either want to swap out Mojo Rawley with J.J. Watt to watch him just completely use his own move against him and just, you know, spear him to death. Or I want to add Rob Gronkowski as Mojo Rawley's manager.
What?
I think we win. Rob Gronkowski has been added. Can I do that?
That's awesome.
You know what? Why not? Why not?
Yes.
Hey, if Ronda Rousey can be on there.
Yeah.
I said as a manager, I don't want to see Rob Gronkowski get injured again. So I kind of want to see that as a manager. Can I do that?
In a phone match.
Yeah.
Party phone match.
I'm not up on these guys. so you're adding two UFC people as managers.
No, two football, one football.
Oh, they're football.
Player.
Oh, they're one football player and who?
Just the football player.
Just Gronkowski.
And we're adding foam.
And foam. Yep.
All right.
I'd watch it.
Presented by
Antonio, you got one ahead on you with those graphics.
Presented by MaxXouT.
Yeah.
There you go. I'm gonna put that. Presented by MaxXouT. Listen, the reason I have to do this, we've had early matches. We had Krista Joseph of Lucha Underground on, I think in the first round. So his match was presented by Lucha Underground. We had presented by Chair Shot Reality with Justin Labar. We gotta give you guys a plug on here too. So
thanks, buddy.
All right. Wow, Eamon? What the hell?
I guess I get to spin the wheel.
You can spin the wheel. He chooses to punish himself. I don't know if this is the way this is supposed to work out at all. Matt's going to fire me from my own show after this one. All right, we're spinning the wheel of Nexus again. Michael Tarver, Darren Young, Wade Barrett, Heath Slater, David Tunga, and Ryback. Skip Sheffield. Yep. Let's see what you got. It's spinning. It's slowing. It's slowing. It's slowing. Still slowing this wheel. Holy crap. And Darren. Yeah. Oh, what do we do there? Michael Tarver. It gave you Michael Tarver.
Was it Tarver?
It was on the line, but it gave you Michael Tarver. Huh.
Oh, God.
So you get to sign somebody to WWE under the rules of the Wheel of Nexus.
Can you re-spin?
Who would I put Tarver against? Who would I care to put Tarver against?
Well, and remember, you got matches on the board. Would you insert him into something that's already on here?
God, I don't even know. I would put... Okay, so going with Bobby's thing from last week, I'll... what match would I take off then? Go over the matches that are on the list real quick for me.
All right, we have left. We have left on our list. Since Nakamura versus AJ Styles is still there, Apollo Crews, Brock Lesnar versus and Bray Wyatt, we have Mojo Rawley versus Baron Corbin with Ron Gronkowski in the corner and foam.
Ron Gronkowski.
Sort of knows nothing about sports and I love it.
No idea. Enzo Amore, Colin Cassidy versus Ronda Rousey and Shane McMahon. Jimmy Uso, Roman Reigns, Nia Jax, Jey Uso, The Rock in a match together.
It's a family reunion. It's not a match.
Blake and Murphy versus The Revival versus American Alpha. Ambos versus Rusev in a suit. What will you do with Michael Tarver?
It'll piss him off or whatever. Take off the Enzo and Cass Rousey McMahon tag match.
Oh, ho, ho, ho.
Oh, he's gonna be mad at you.
Yeah, whatever. And put in since Bobby used people that were on the wheel along with the people he got, I'll just do Michael Tarver versus Darren Young in the battle of who could care less.
Oh. Say that, don't you put that Darren Young in.
Can we just put a frowny face under after? There you go. Since I just went down the entire line, I'm not going to. I don't know. Should I read the card back again? What's the rule on that?
Sure, we got it.
All right. So the final tally, again, graduated. We have Zane and Zane versus Owens versus who was the other guy? Shit.
No.
Here we go. There's now I got the rest of the list. Okay, I'm good. We got Finn versus Owens versus Sami Zayn is graduated. We still have Nakamura versus AJ Styles, Apollo Crews versus Brock Lesnar versus Bray Wyatt, Mojo Rawley versus Baron Corbin with that football guy in foam, Jey Uso, Jimmy Uso, Roman Reigns, Nia Jax, and The Rock. Enzo, wait, no, we removed that. We removed Enzo, Colin Cassidy, and Shane McMahon. And there we go. I mean, Ronda Rousey's back on the table. Blake and Murphy versus Revival versus Alpha Male. American Alpha. Dean Ambrose versus Rusev. And now Michael Tarver versus Darren Young. I think I got everything there. Oh, boy. Oh, boy.
Del Rio
versus...
Aries.
Austin Aries. So, do you have like the graphics ready to go for that one or something? I can't even imagine. So, that has been your Mayhem Mania for this week. Round 9, is that right? Round 9.
Jesus Christ.
Next week is the Patreon in the Bank match.
I was going to say, do we get the book of Roadblock? Was it Mayhem Block or whatever?
Yeah, Mayhem Block. There you go. Maybe we should do a Mayhem Slam. There you go. You can play along at home at the Mayhem Mania home game. The rules are whatever you want it to be if you haven't figured that out yet by now. So check that out. Thank you, Mayhem, Mainstream Matt, and everybody else at MaxXouT for playing along. Real quick, I think we do need to touch on a few of us here attended the Arnold Classic. NXT was there. I was there on assignment of sorts, helping out Mainstream Matt with KDKA And actually, we got to talk with several NXT guys. So we talked to Corey Graves, a friend of the show, Sterling James Keenan, over the years. I got to catch up with Cesaro and talk about IWC as well. You know, formerly Claudio Castagnoli. It's been around here. But also, again, I got to talk to Alexa Bliss and Baron Corbin. And I got to say, guys, Baron Corbin has won my heart and mind after this. And despite the fact that afterwards my Instagram was doing homages to him of telling Jen Carlins to eat that food at Max and Irma's. But I thought it was a really good experience. Like I said, we talked about that a little bit earlier. They kind of had their own section and it was lit by itself separately because it looked like it was just kind of thrown in the corner in a convention center last year, right? Like they actually had their own lighting. They had a giant screen up and it was pretty cool NXT experience in the middle of the Arnold Classic. And the Arnold Classic is like bodybuilding and then there's all these booths all lined up around the everything. And it was a really, really cool experience. I only got to see like three matches after everything I was running around with, to be honest, but, you guys got to catch a little bit there. You were hanging out. What were your impressions of NXT at the Arnold?
Well, me and Elliot went to the Arnold 2 years ago and there was like a WWE experience thing at that time too. And basically what it was a cardboard cutout of Kurt Angle and then an arrow pointing downstairs. And me and Elliot went downstairs and there was nothing there. There was just nothing. It was just this cardboard cutout of Kurt Angle just pointing to nothing. So
what the hell?
I know it was really disappointing. What? So
was it a trap?
I think it was a
and
trap.
And you were late?
Yeah, I think you're right. I think it was actually a portal to WWE Piledriver in Niagara Falls. It just like shot you right over there like it was a Super Mario Brothers green pipe. So I'm glad that neither Elliot nor I got shot over to Niagara Falls. But I was impressed. Unfortunately, me and Elliot had to watch a bunch of Eastern Europeans that probably chew Diana Ball for breakfast and take HGH for dessert, stick wrestle each other, and then lift 440-pound logs over their heads. So me personally, the NXT thing was really cool. The setup was really neat. If you're a member of the audience, you could sign up to try your hand in being an NXT superstar. And what that entailed was having Albert scream at you to do flips in the ring. Well, you know, that's pretty cool. But we only saw the Eva Marie match.
Which actually wasn't that bad.
No, it wasn't that bad.
She took on the Ivy chick.
Yeah.
Who I saw wrestle twice.
Right. Yep. Yeah. So, I mean, that's my two cents. What did you think, Elliot?
The setup was outstanding. What they did that I thought worked really well was the fact that they had the ring and everything. They had the whole NXT experience set up right as you walked in. So you were able to go straight to it and then kind of make your way around the rest of the expo. It was really easy to get in and out of. There was like plenty of seating too. So if you want to just chill out and watch wrestling all day, you totally could have done it. Mm-hmm. I really only caught the Arnold Triple H face-off, which was excellent. The Eva Marie match. And the training session featuring Prince Albert and Enzo Amore, which was entertaining. So that was pretty cool. But the whole experience was actually pretty awesome. So I definitely suggest it's worth your $10 entrance fee.
It was only $10 to get into that thing?
It was $10. It was $30 for three tickets. So if you got three friends, it's going to be $10 a piece.
Holy crap.
So, you know, it's a deal and a half. You're going to see some pretty awesome stuff. So I suggest everybody go.
I was going to say, considering, like, you can't get tickets in Pittsburgh when they come through. I imagine it was probably the same when they were in Columbus and Cleveland.
Yep.
So to drop $10, you're getting in at that point. And just go check out a day of NXT. Like, I'm sure it's a little different, but they were fun matches, what I saw.
Yeah.
Of them.
And it was 9 to 5. I mean, you could spend the whole day there.
Yeah. Yeah. I saw the list. There was actually a list on one of the sites of all the matches from the day. And were like 20 matches.
Yeah.
Crazy. We walked in. It was like, it was right after the Arnold thing. And they did a Q&A with Triple H, which is on WWE.com. And like the next match was Baron Corbin and Finn Balor. And we're like, is Finn Balor curtain jerking here? But again, they've been on since 9 o'clock in the morning.
Right.
That's crazy. And a few of them, of course, wrestling, twice. They had lineups for, autographs throughout the day. That was really fun. Did you guys notice this? There were a lot of autograph sessions with wrestlers that you have not seen on TV yet.
Mm-hmm.
Like King Constantine, I think, is one of them. But Johnny Gargano, a friend of the show, was a part of the show as well. But no, it was in these pictures, if you're on video, are actually from Jen Carlin's, who was there on hand as well. There we are hanging with Baron Corbin. Corbin was awesome. We got to chat it up with a few of the people there on and off camera, but he probably talked with us, you know, just as long off camera as he did beforehand. And I asked him about, because he was talking about how everything's clicking and the guys that he's learning from. And you guys have had this discussion, and we've had discussion before about, you know, back in that one, like around the Samoa Joe tag team arrival or what, or takeover or whatever. I was like, hey, we've been talking about, like, you know, is that when things started? Do you feel that's when things started clicking for you? And he's like, absolutely. That's when he got it, right? Like, it started kicking in and it was easy. Also super tall dude. And that's, I'm 6'4" and this guy dwarfed me. And I was like, wow. Like, my eye line is his chin. So, but no, really cool, really awesome. There's also a really cool thing. So they had this kind of production tower on the one side, or platform, where they had the camera that goes to the big screen. And there was a point where Triple H was just like sitting up there, like they filmed some spot up there probably for the network. But he turned around and just him watching the tryouts, Albert screaming at everybody for an hour. It was an interesting scene of just like seeing Triple H looking at the potential future of his company. That was kind of a special moment for me. Again, thanks, Jen Carlin. If you want to check it out, I believe these are all, and there's Jen with Corbin, and of all people, she looks the tiniest next to him. So I kind of want to go back next year just to go check out the NXT stuff, to be quite honest. Absolutely. It's not a bad trip from Pittsburgh. It's like 3 hours for us.
Great.
And it was a lot of fun. Maybe we'll have the opportunity to talk with these guys again or something through some other means. But really, really awesome, really worth it. If you're in the area, if you're driving distance to Columbus, check out the Arnold, if nothing else, for this. And I don't know about the rest of it. Not really into the rest of it myself, but really interesting. All right. So with that, it's time to learn, and I think we learned a lot. What'd you learn from wrestling this week, Eamon?
Me? I learned from wrestling this week that I can love wrestling again on Raw. The Kevin Owens Neville match, which was spectacular. The tag title match, which was surprisingly amazing. Like, yeah, there's a lot of talented people right now in the WWE.
Mm-hmm. Talented people getting a chance to flourish, too.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. So, Bobby F. J-Town, what'd you learn from wrestling this week?
I learned the line forms here for refunds on AJ Y2AJ shirts. I didn't buy one. I tweeted out that I bought one, and I got a couple retweets on that. But I just bought that shirt. That was a really great segment, by the way, too.
It was absolutely, and the best town to do that in too. Mm-hmm. Elliot, what'd you learn from wrestling this week?
I learned that if you want to meet a woman who can fry a bratwurst and detail your car, you got to go to Iowa.
Absolutely. Stosh, how about you?
I learned that, and this is also a retread from earlier today, but I learned if you want to make it into the WWE Hall of Fame, just mention something about Georgia in your theme music. You got Cobb County, Georgia, and you got Bad Street, Atlanta, GA.
Yes.
I'm sure wherever Godfather was from was somewhere in Georgia.
Sure, yeah. Sure, why not?
Yeah,
that's where he found the best women.
Hot Atlanta, baby!
all these women.
Happy International Women's Day!
Happy International Women's Day from the chat room. I'm gonna if this isn't in here, I'm gonna actually kind of co-opt somebody else's what they learned, because I think that's what I learned as well. But from the chat room, Wheels is saying he learned that Raw was entertaining last night. Of course. Did there not? Oh, there was what I learned. Okay. All right. Matt Carlin's, because I was, if he didn't say this, it had to be said. He learned that Triple H gets cranky because he's craving French toast. Hashtag French toast pop. If you were there for the Arnold part, remember their QA and they're asking about cheat meals, and Arnold's like, I eat raisins. I can't eat anything. If the part about, like, somebody told him, what it looks like before you eat it is how you'll look after. And that scared him away from pretty much bad food, full stop, for his entire life, I guess. So there you go. But then Triple H gets in, oh, like some fresh toast. I'm a breakfast guy. Give him some pancakes and just like big pop. Like all those muscle guys that haven't eaten anything for a while just went nuts. Alex Carr has learned that Raw is even better when you can actually watch it instead of just reading the results. He's West Coast, and he has issues with the internet in the cabin in the woods that he's apparently at these days. Other than that, I learned those screens were really hot, guys. Those LED board screens.
Oh, yeah?
I don't know. There's so much more I could probably throw it in there. But I got close enough to the ramp to check that out. Other than that, it was a pretty cool experience at the Arnold. And when you're that close to it in the backstage, everybody's honestly cooler than an indie show. Can I say that? I don't want to throw that out there. I don't want to throw anybody under the bus. I have a lot of fun at the indie shows. Mm-hmm. But a lot of times, at least in that realm, you know, everybody was maybe it's because it was what it was and not a full on show.
Right.
But everybody was pretty laid back and really cool to work with. So it was a good experience there. Thank you. Thank you to the NXT crew that we did talk with there. Look out for KDKA, CBS Pittsburgh. There should be some stuff popping up hopefully in the next week or two. But I think they're going to be stringing out that footage a little bit here. Probably looking for something when Rock comes to town next week as well. In regards to that. So I know it has to go through all the people and we got a lot of stuff. So
Garza.
It's out of my hands. Garza. Garza's here. Oh shit. I'm so sorry. I am so sorry, Garza. Where are you at?
Okay.
I'm trying to find your button. What's up, Garza?
Well, I've been following the Hogan Gawker trial virtually.
Oh, we almost made it.
I have unfortunately learned that Terry Bollea's penis is not 10 inches.
Oh, man.
Hulk Hogan's 10-inch python.
Yep. Not enough vitamins.
I was looking for something. I'm over on WrestleZone, and one of the headlines over here is everything you need to know about the Hulk Hogan Gawker trial. No, that's a false statement. Absolutely, that is a false statement.
I wouldn't say need to know.
Jeez.
Everything you should know.
Could that be the title?
Damn it. And I'm also realizing I've once again forgot to use the voicemail that was sent to us this week. You can call us 412-206-WMS0. We do listen to your voicemails, even if I don't remember to put them in the show. But go ahead and listen after the credits here to listen to what our buddy had to say about Mayhem Mania and the such. We're going to tack that on here. Thank you so much. First of all, MaxXouT for joining us. MaxOutBand.com. Go buy the album on iTunes and Google Play and the Amazons, right?
That's right. Thanks, buddy. Yeah,
Thank you so much for having us on. This was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Also, if you guys...
I love this game.
It's going on sale next year.
Oh, it's great.
There you go. Kickstarted. Check out
Rob Gronkowski foam matches.
Did not see that coming. Okay. By the way, I put the moves in Slack, and there's just
there's just a
bunch of GIFs of Mad Mike of tables being flipped. So there you go.
I'm gonna critique Sorg on how he thought Rob Gronkowski should be spelled.
You mean Ron Gronkowski?
The MMA fighter?
The MMA fighter, Ron Gronkowski.
Sounds like an MMA fighter. I don't know. I don't watch anything. I made a rule. You know what you all learned from Wrestling Mayhem Show this week? I don't follow any sport that isn't pre-scripted. So I guess I should let UFC into my life. Thank you so much. MaxOutBand.com, at Bobby F. J. Town, at Eamon2, please. And of course, our buddy at Antonio Garza, thewrestlingrevolution.com. So great recaps over there. Go watch it. Check out the board and follow them. I'm Mike Sorg, at Sorgatron on the Twitters. Wrestling Mayhem Show. Follow us. Tweet us. Like us. All this stuff. We'll see you guys next time, live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com, 9 p.m. Eastern Time. Mayhem out. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at SorgatronMedia.com.
Guys are cool.
Hey, Daniel Perry again. Hey, I know you guys got a live stream coming up a little bit later on tonight, but I just want to tell you what I've learned from wrestling this week. Sami Zayn will be the next Daniel Bryan, and Ryback will be the next CM Punk. You ever watch the footage from between Ryback and Curtis Axel? You'll see what I mean. All right, guys. Well, hope you guys have a good day, and I'll look at your recap on Wednesday. Take care. Bye.